Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
We'd just like to take a moment before our liturgy begins to rehearse with you our Hosanna, which is our opening hymn tonight. It's not in your hymnals, but it's a very simple refrain that we'd like for you to sing along with us as you feel comfortable. So we'll play it for you four times now so you can hear it, and we'll ask you to just sing it with us one time.
Thank you.
Good evening. Welcome, Bishop Matano and Father White. We greet all of our parishioners and those who may be visiting and invite you to join in our Eucharistic celebration today as we celebrate God's presence in our lives. These rich Sunday readings include numerous phrases and expressions that have become part of the Sunday liturgy and other devotions. But most of all, they reveal how each event of the Passion of Christ had been announced by the prophets in the scriptures and by Christ himself, thus confirming that he was the one who was to come. The celebrant of this Mass is Bishop Matano. Bishop will be assisted by Deacon Joe Placious. Our readings today begin on page 1049. At the beginning of the Gospel, we will be using the program available in the pew. You will read the parts indicated as a C. As we get ready for our Eucharistic celebration, we ask that you silence all cell phones and take a quiet moment or two to prepare our hearts to hear God's word and to participate in the offering of this Mass.
Please stand. Kindly place your palms over your right shoulder and turn to the rear of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Peace be with you. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church throughout the world the beginning of the solemn celebration of our Lord's sacred paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that, being made by the grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Thank you. May the Lord be in your heart and on your lips, that you may proclaim his gospel worthily and well. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew.
Thank you.
When they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethage, to the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tied, and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on an ass, and on the colt, the foal of an ass.'" The disciple went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the ass and the colt and put their garments on them, and he sat thereon. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road and spread them on the road, and the crowd that went before him and that followed him shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
We now invite you to join in singing our opening refrain, "Hosanna."
Dear brethren, brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna.
Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, you caused our Savior to take on our flesh and submit to the cross. Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and who reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
First reading is a reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this evening can be found on page 29 in the Green Gather hymnal, My God, My God.
My God, my God, oh, why have you abandoned me?
Our second reading is a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gospel worthy and well in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him the 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on he looked for the opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare you to eat the Passover?"
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus has ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me."
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him one after another,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He said in reply,
"He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
Then Judas, his betrayer, said in reply,
"Surely it is not I, Rabbi."
He answered,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and giving to his disciples, said,
"Take and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on I shall not drink of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you anew in the kingdom of my Father.
Then, after singing the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him in reply,
"Though all may have their faith shaken, mine will never be."
Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
Peter said to him,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will never deny you."
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took along Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee. He began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me."
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will."
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again,
"My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done."
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with sorrows and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him."
Immediately, he went over to Jesus and said,
"Hail, Rabbi."
And he kissed him. Jesus answered him,
"Friend, do what you have come for."
Then, stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out as against a robber, with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass, that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away of Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him, at a distance as far as the highest priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priest and entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward who stayed.
"This man said, 'I can destroy the temple of God, and within 3 days rebuild it.'"
The high priest rose and addressed him.
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him in reply,
"You have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his robe and said,
"He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? You have now heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
They say in reply,
"He deserves to die."
Then they spat his face and struck him, while some spread him, saying, "Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said,
'You two were with Jesus the Galilean.'
But he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
'I do not know what you are talking about.'
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there,
'This man was with Jesus the Nazarene.'
And he said to them,
'I do not know the man.'
A little later, the bystanders came over and said to Peter,
'Surely you two are one of them. Even your speech gives you away.'
At that he began to curse and to swear,
'I do not know the man.'
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, 'Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and began to weep bitterly. Now it was morning. All the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, saying that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, 'They say, they said, fleeing the money into the temple, he departed and went off and handed himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said,
'It is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the price of blood.'
After a consultation, they used it to buy the poorest field as a burial place for the foreigners. That is why the field even today is called the field of blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took the 30 pieces of silver in value of a man with a price of his head, a price set by some of the Israelites, and they paid it out of the poorest field, just as the Lord had condemned me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, Pontius Pilate, and he questioned him.
'Are you the king of the Jews?'
Jesus said,
'You say so.'
And when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
Do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
"Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?"
For he knew that it was sought to envy that they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him." The chief priests and the elders pursued the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
"Which of the two do you want me to release to you?"
They answered,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to him,
"Then what shall I do with Jesus called Christ?"
They all said,
"Let him be crucified."
But he said,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted it louder,
"Let him be crucified."
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves."
And the whole people said in reply,
"This is what is upon us and upon our children."
Then he released Barabbas to them, but after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak about him. Waving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and wreath on his right hand. And kneeled before him, they mocked him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They spat upon him and took the wreath and kept striking him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressing him on his own clothes, and led him off to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a Syrian named Simon. This man was pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted him, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garment by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And they placed over his head with written charge against him, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by relieving him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself, if you are the Son of God, and come down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him and said,
"You save others, he cannot save himself, so he is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. You trusted in God, let him deliver him now if he wants him. For what he said, I am the Son of God."
The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From the noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,"
which means,
"My God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"This one is calling for Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine and, putting on reed, gave it to him and drink. But the rest said,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him."
But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave out his spirit. Please all kneel. Please stand. And behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus fell greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and said,
"Truly, this was the Son of God."
There were many women looking on from a distance who had followed Jesus from Galilee ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the son of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Hemerite named Joseph, who was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in a clean linen and laid it in his new tomb that he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance of the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there, facing the tomb. The next day, one of the following day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, Pilate said to them,
"The guard is yours. Go, secure it as best you can."
So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to a stone and setting the guard. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It is my joy to bring to you the greetings of Father Whelan. I visit Father Whelan quite regularly. We are in regular communication as we work together to provide for this beautiful parish of the Holy Cross. As the days unfold, Father will be able to give you more information about the pastoral governance of the parish. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. There is no more eloquent homily than that we have just heard from the lips of our Savior and recorded in Holy Scripture, his sacred passion. And so, Holy Mother, the Church asks that today we only give a brief reflection. I offer this reflection for all of us to contemplate. Why did the Son of God He who was divine, who lived with the Father and the Holy Spirit in the celestial kingdom, come down to earth and allow himself to be crucified? The answer is clear. Jesus loves us so much that he wanted to immerse himself into the human condition completely, totally, allowing himself to endure every challenge, heartache, and suffering that is a part of the human condition, to show us visibly that he is a part of everything we do in this life. The Passion is his invitation to each of us to let Jesus into our lives in all its different aspects, in all the different crosses that we carry. Because in love, the Savior came to live among us. In love, he continues to accompany us. And soon, in the most holy Eucharist, in the receiving of his precious body and blood in Holy Communion, his love explodes into perfection as our very person is united to the person of Christ. As he has come to us to embrace us, let us embrace the Savior of humanity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Knowing the Father's tremendous love for us, that he would send his own Son into the world that we might be saved, we have every confidence the loving Father now receives these our prayers of petition.
We pray that those to be baptized and received into the church this Easter may be kept safe from doubt and strong against all temptation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that those who have never heard of Jesus may come to know how much he suffered for them and may believe in his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that the saving death of Jesus may restore in us a deep reverence and respect for every human life, for which he sacrificed his own life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that during this Holy Week, those in our families and parish who no longer practice the faith may hear God's call and return. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that travelers may experience protection, strength, and the joy of friends and family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that the sick may be healed and the departed welcomed into the joy of everlasting life, especially Gino D'Alessandro, George McCory, and for Celine Redmond, for whom this Mass is being offered. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pause a moment and make our own private petitions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, receive the prayers we offer to you as we beg the intercession of your Mother and our Mother Mary, Our Lady of Sorrows, who stood beneath the cross to receive your dead Son into her arms. And so together we all beg her intercession, praying, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Please join in our offertory hymn, number 418 in the green gather hymnal, number 418, Jesus the Lord.
Jesus,
by you, Lord God of all creation, for tree of goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. And this water and wine may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. My brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and all of God's holy church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for us sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so, with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition to Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, and your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Cosmas, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Savior of the world. You are the Savior. Thank you.
So we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to one another now a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace be with you. God bless you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, through your death, your death. To your commandments, and never let me be parted from you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. What has passed our lips as food, O Lord, may we possess in purity of heart. For what was given to us in time may be our healing for eternity. Before we conclude, I want to express my deepest gratitude for all of you for your very gracious welcome here today, certainly to Father Ramirez, to Deacon Joseph, to Sister Kathy, to our beautiful choir, to our wonderful altar servers, to all who participated in making this liturgy so very beautiful this evening. Again, I ask for your prayers for Father Whelan, but as I look at the way the parish functions, it appears he's running it by remote control. And every time I visit him, there's really nothing he doesn't know that's going on. So he certainly is in you are in his mind and in his heart, and please keep him in your good prayers. Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, may you lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Bishop, in the name of Father Whelan, in the name of Father Reeve, in the name of all the community of Holy Cross, we thank you for being with us. You know, this is your home, this is your house. Please come anytime to celebrate with us. Okay? Thank you, Bishop.
We have just a couple announcements this evening. It's not too late to sneak in a little Lenten service. Please consider helping to clean or decorate the church or gym for Easter. See the bulletin for dates and times. We hope to see many of our parishioners and friends at this week's celebration of Holy Week and at the Easter services. The schedule can be found in the bulletin. Thank you to all who have already signed up to serve as liturgical ministers for Holy Week and Easter. We still need Eucharistic ministers for several of the liturgies and are looking for those who are willing to be served by having their feet washed Holy Thursday evening. We need 8 more feet. Sign-ups are in the parish center foyer. Please see the bulletin or website at holycrossrochester.org for times of services and for all parish details.
The Lord be with you. Blessed be the name of the Lord, now and forever. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. And I wish to you and to all your families a very blessed and holy Easter.
Our song of sending forth into Holy Week, number 397, Tree of Life. We will sing verses 1 through 4.
Mm-hmm.